Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. It's amazing how we may be few in number, but God is always in the mix, because he says where two or three are gathered in my name, I am in the midst. Amen? Amen. Good morning, good morning, good morning. I see some smiles, I see some frowns. Why you are frowning? You should be smiling today. Amen? Amen. Come on up. How many of us really, really, really feel like we want to praise God this morning? Amen. I was. This morning by Brother Michael Kim, and our scripture reading will be done by Brother David Grayson. Brother Father, come to you once again just to say thank you for waking us up this morning, closing in our right mind, able to inhale, exhale, enjoy the air to breathe. Thank you this morning, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to look upon the eyes of our loved ones once again, be able to say to them, thank you. Lord God, when we came down and looked into our refrigerator, we had food to eat. We looked at our closet, we had clothes to wear, shoes on our feet. Thank you. Thank you, God. God, we thank you for every time that we're able to come to the throne of grace. Every time we're able to assemble together, we just lift up your holy name this morning. We give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise this morning. Lord God, not because we've been so good, not because we've done the things that we were supposed to do. Lord God, we're not even able to call upon you. Lord God, we just thank you for your grace and for your mercy. Your grace and your mercy. The reason we're here this morning, Lord God, your grace and your mercy. Thank you, God. Lord God, we just want to worship you and honor you this morning. We just want to give you all the praise, all the glory this morning. You're worthy. You're worthy of all the praise. You're worthy.
God. Lord God, we just pray for our loved ones and our sick and shut in. We pray for our Mount Olive family, Lord God, those that are bereaved right now. Lord God, we pray for those that have lost loved ones, Lord God, and we pray that you be a comforter to them right now, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, we just pray that you would put your loving arms around them, Lord God, and let them know there's a better day. Lord God, go into the hospital. See about the sick. Go into the operating room, Lord God. Bless the hands of the doctors performing surgery, Lord God. In the name of Jesus. Lord God, go into the nursing home. See about the elderly. Let them know we haven't forgot about them, Lord God. Let them know that their years of service meant something, Lord God. Strengthen them, Lord God. In the name of Jesus. Lord God, bless our youth, our young people. Bless them as they go to school each day, Lord God. Bless them as they try to get an education, Lord God. And Lord God, bless them as they try to be more like you. Standing up for what's right, Lord God. Standing up for gun laws. Lord God, things that young people shouldn't even have to worry about. We just thank you, Lord. We just thank you. Lord God, now we pray that your hand will be with our leader, with our pastor, Lord God. Bless Reverend Fletcher and his family, Lord God, as they minister to your people. Bless them in their going and in their coming, Lord God. Bless them in everything that they do, Lord God. Anoint them with your Holy Spirit, Lord God. Bless their work. Bless their work, Lord God. In the name of Jesus. Now, Father God, we pray that you would be in our midst. Oh, Lord God, you're welcome in this place. Oh, Lord God, bring your Holy Spirit upon this place. Like never before, Lord God, we just want to worship you this morning. We want to honor you this morning. We just thank you for your Holy Spirit. Be within us, Lord God. Oh, Lord God, someone needs to be saved this morning. Someone is laying it all down before you this morning, Lord God. Let them come forth asking, what must I do? Many other blessings. We ask in your Son's name. In the name of Jesus. The mighty, mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And amen.
But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives. He gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended to the very one, descended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and teachers. The word of God for the people of God. May be God, may God be with each of us each day next week.
Follows. All high school seniors who are graduating this year, and plan to attend a college university in the fall, please submit your name to Sister Tiara Robinson or Reverend Bell McGaskett as soon as possible. And in celebrating our 137th anniversary, 137 years from Mount Olive, and we are having a series of events. We are having the Parade of Saints Memorial Service on April the 22nd, that's Sunday afternoon, April the 22nd, at 4 p.m. And if you will wear white, we would greatly appreciate it. You don't have to, but if you will, please do that. And please come out and help us honor our and remember our deceased members. We have quite a few of them who have done great things for this church. This afternoon's hymns of the church program, we're planning to have that, but we're going to postpone that until a later date. This is where we're going to let us know. And also, we've got a little more than a month, about 6 or 7 weeks before that date. And what we're asking all of our members to do, all of us to do, is to contribute $137 toward the anniversary. And what we're trying to do is pay down the mortgage on our church. So if you will please dig deep and give with your heart, $137 for commemorating our 137th anniversary, that would be a great thing. Paying down a mortgage is not an easy job, and any time you can put anything extra towards it, that gets you that much closer to having smaller bounds and more money that the church is able to keep in its pocket. So please do that. Also, the youth will immediately meet after the 10 o'clock service on the third Sunday, which is the 15th, in the fellowship hall. So please be prepared for the youth. I don't see them in the room this morning, but the parents, let your kids know that they need to be prepared to make their presentations on that Sunday. If you are a ministry leader and your ministry is in need of funds, you need to turn in your vouchers by April 15th in order to be able to receive the funds that you've requested. So don't delay. If you need something, turn your vouchers in by the 15th, and that's by the third Sunday of every single month for the coming month. And last thing, on Wednesday, which is April the 11th, a Bible study, the women's ministry will be serving us in the kitchen. So we look forward to celebrating and worshiping with them in the kitchen with a smile and a hug as we receive our goodies that night. So thank you very much. Those are all of the announcements that we have for this morning.
Come on, give God a hand of praise in the house this morning. flashy stuff that you see on commercials. But folk laying there, just the fact that they know that somebody there, you can watch their eyes. I saw a brother the other day, he just watched a certain woman out. Everywhere she went, his eyes went. And all around that hospital room. And everybody in that room knew that he was watching her. Yeah. She moved me. That's right. And we need to celebrate. Because sometimes we celebrate the other stuff. But we don't celebrate the folk just being there for us. But all the flashy stuff is not there. Come on, hold your gifts up before the Lord. Now together, God, this is my gift. It is a seed. And I planted in this ministry. I'm expecting a harvest in this ministry and in my life. I'm expecting it to be exceedingly abundantly above all that I ask, all that I think, and all that I can imagine. Lord, I thank you that I'm able to give in Christ Jesus' name. Come on, put your hand together and bless the Lord. This is why we say all things come of thee. She came back here flashing. So, and we bless them and we thank God for them, amen. And let them know that you we just appreciate them coming together, being husband and wife, and the blessedness of their presence. Amen. Praise be to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Amen. Let me say this. Yesterday, sometime yesterday, they let me remind me, you never know when you need God. We had a funeral here yesterday, not one of our members, but from the community that used our church. Young man was born in 1979. He was home, laying on his sofa, minding his own business. In the apartment upstairs over him, somebody came into that apartment to kill somebody. In the process, before he killed the guy, he shot one shot through the floor. The bullet he shot through the floor went through the floor and shot the guy laying on his sofa and killed him. Then the guy killed the guy he came in there to kill. So two people got killed. You don't know when you're going to need God. Yeah, not somebody into somebody's business, but in his own house, laying on his sofa. Young man that we had to bury on yesterday. You don't know when you're going to need God.
And in the midst of it, two preachers got asked to do the eulogy. Yeah. See, sometimes I wonder why stuff come to us. Two preachers, and both of them scheduled, and both of them come ready, in uniform, ready to preach. And so, seeing that, I realized God was up to something. And I immediately pulled them together and said, let's make sure we work this out good. It may be division in the family. Some of the family wanted this preacher, some of the family wanted the other preacher. But the preachers can't get into the family division. Our job is to bring healing. So we had both of them to preach, because we had to show that we was beyond the division that the enemy had brought. And both of them did a good job preaching and sharing important messages to the family. Now, if preachers, we'd have messed that up, and I say we, because even though I had nothing to do with it, yes, I'm a preacher, so I'm connected to it. It affects all of us. We would have sent the wrong message. And sometime in the midst of it, God is doing more than that. And what happened was, the preachers had to put personalities, egos aside, and be servants of God. And they did a beautiful job of doing it. And sometime that makes all the difference in the world. Well, then God was up to something. Two people were killed at the same time. Then we found out that the mother of the boy, it was her second son that got killed. Yeah. And I saw something yesterday I ain't seen before. She ain't sat over there in that seat. She got a chair right there and sat at the head of that coffin, doing the whole service. And doing the whole service, leaned over there, because this was her second son she got to bear. She needed two preachers. There was two different races, because the boy was black and white together. So there was two different races in the mix. See, sometimes God is far up to far more. But we've got to be able to see what's happening in the mix beyond the circumstances. And so it turned out beautiful. Turned out to be a blessing to get folk through what they was going through. Yeah. And then the young man had two children. Yeah. They needed two preachers yesterday. Well, we got a preacher for today, amen. And the personality of Brother Fred Pennington will come forth and share a word. A young man that I've seen grow in the Spirit of God. Somebody I will watch surrender themselves, their personalities, and all that they are to God. Person who willing to say, God, I want to be what you want rather than what I want. Committed himself to being a servant, a preacher, God's mouthpiece. And so it is he that will come before us and share word from the Lord. Brother that I thank God for, a gift that God has given unto us. It is he, Brother Fred, the Reverend Fred Pennington, that will come before us and share a word from the Lord. Amen. All right. I joined this group a long time ago, traveling around the country, doing a lot of shows. Then the Lord showed me I was doing it all wrong. He told me to spread his word through all of my songs. So I'm asking you to guide me right by myself. I need you, Jesus. Can't depend on nobody else. I need you. Yes, I do.
Yes, I do.
I need you. Yes, I do. Since I decided to make Jesus my choice, the road ain't been easy, but he kept me right on course. So many times I felt like giving up, but Lord, you kept your arms around me and covered me with your love. Lord, I wanna thank you for being good to me. You opened up the doors so that I could see. I need you. Yes, I do. Lord, I need you. Yes, I do. I cast my cares upon you. I need you, Jesus, to see me through. I can't make it by myself. It's just you and me, Jesus, and no one else. The world they're living in has grown cold. They're killing the young, and they're even killing the old. I need you. Yes, I do. Lord, I need you. Yes, I do. I need you, Lord. Yes, I do. Lord, I need you. Yes, I do. Just like a flower needs a rain.
Yes, I do.
Just like a conductor needs his train.
Yes, I do.
Just like a highway needs two lanes.
Yes, I do.
And just a window needs a window pane.
Yes, I do.
Lord, I need you. Yes, I do.
I do. Yes, I do.
Just like a carpenter needs a hammer.
Yes, I do.
Just like a child sometimes needs manners.
Yes, I do.
Just like the sun needs to shine.
Yes, I
need you, Jesus.
Need you
all the time.
Yes, I do.
Lord, I need you.
Yes, I do.
Yes, I do. Lord, I need. Yes, I do.
Yes, I do.
Yes, Lord,
I need
you, Lord.
Yes, I do.
Oh, I need
you.
Yes, I do.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. How many of y'all really know? Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I realized a long time ago I couldn't do it by myself. Mm-hmm. Just wasn't working. I needed. It took me a while. I'm a little thick-headed. It took me a while to accept the fact I needed it. I was hard-headed, but I eventually realized I needed it. Yes, I do. Please pray with me. Most Heavenly Father, as I stand before this desk, in front of your people, I ask that you decrease me and increase thee so that I can bring a word to your people. These and other blessings I ask in this name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. I watched your expressions. A lot of you verbally said, but most of us were a little dumbfounded. As we sat there and listened, two kids. Two preachers. The woman's second child. And he was the father of two kids. Two by two. I listened to that and I add that to the myriad of things I see happening in this world we live in every day. Drive by shootings. Mothers drive, but parents getting in the car and driving off the cliff with their children. People carrying guns to school and shooting up things. Children marching on the, trying to tell adults or needing to tell adults what's the right thing to do. They got to march all around the country just to pray so they can go to school and not have to worry about being shot. Sad state of affairs. Gangster's paradise, I heard. Ride down the street, you 25 years ago, and I'm not telling my age, but you could ride down the street and couldn't get down the street. We didn't have to worry about speeding because the children was in the street playing. Now you ride down the street, it's a racetrack. Ain't no children out there anymore. Used to go to the park. Go to the park now, all you see is drug dealers. Dope head. Sorry about that, but the kids won't go no more. That's the world I live in every day. Used to be a kind respect for the elderly. See, an elderly person, they'd help them out, they'd carry their bags, they'd do all kind of nice things to assist them. Seriously, those people of my generation remember that because we used to have to do it. Now, if you're over 60 and got a little gray, you're easy talking. I'm just telling you what I know. That's the world I live in every day. And then I get on the TV and I listen to all the hoopla and what's going on, and the biggest cry is, it's time for the church to be the church. Now the people that's making that statement and that call obviously hadn't been to the church in a minute. Because see, the church got its own issues.
look at this place, the seats in the place. Yeah. Look, the church has its own issue. We're fighting for souls. And it's a competition. It ain't like it used to be where people would bring their willies. We've got to get out there and fight for them. The pool of applicants is not that large anymore. There are 20 and 30-year-olds that are parents that they never went to church and they'll never bring their kids unless it's a few. But they say it's time for the church to be the church. I thought about that, and as I decided on what to speak on this morning, I thought we needed to be clear, first of all, that the church is not just these four walls or what's in. Because you see, when Jesus used to preach, it was by the water or on the hillside. So it didn't have to be enclosed. But the church, by definition, is a body of believers. Those who believe in Jesus the Christ, his Father, life after death, and the Holy Spirit. That's what the church is. Ponder this, and I'm saying, okay, so what does that say to me when they're telling me it's time for the church to be the church? Because I'm a believer. I believe in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. I have been here some Sundays, and the Holy Ghost had people bouncing off the walls. So I know it's real. And then I know how to eat. Holy Spirit has worked in my life. Miracles are still happening. So I know it's real. I chose for a topic what the church can do in time. What the church can do in times like these. And because I just define the church as a group of individuals with the same or similar or like beliefs, I believe that what I'm about to say applies to all of us. I chose from the Bible, from 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verses 11 through 15. And just a little background story. Solomon had built the temple. His dad laid the plan for the temple. But his dad, David, wasn't able to carry it out. And God said, well, your son Solomon will build it for you. Solomon had finished. After he finished, he given this long, beautiful prayer to the Lord. God, doing things in his time, responded. Starting with verse 11, chapter 7, it says, now when Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord and the royal palace and had succeeded in carrying out all he had in mind to do in the temple of the Lord and in his own palace, the Lord appeared to him at night and said, he does come at night.
Don't have to always be late in the midnight hour either. Because I remember many nights he came to me and had me turn this way, and if I would have went that way, and it wasn't midnight. So he came to him in the night and said, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. That need we was talking about earlier. You need God's help to turn. Because if you kept going, you know, you ain't going to want to turn to be such a good, but that's another story. Turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. He gave a prescription. Reverend Crutcher, we're running around trying to figure out how we can get more people in church. What we can do. The community leaders are trying to figure out what they need to do to stop the violence. But see, God gave a prescription. He said, if my people, that's the church, that's the believers, that's those of y'all who confess God as your Savior, would humble themselves. Now, you know, I know living in this day and time, it's hard to humble yourself. I got this nice car. I got a nice job. I dress up every day. And I might not speak to that person that ride by me on the bicycle in the parking lot. I'm guilty of that. I don't know about y'all, but I'm guilty of that. But I got to humble myself. Because first of all, I'm no better than he is. He was created by God, and the only difference between me and him is the grace of God. That's the only difference. Except by the grace of God. I got to go down. We've got to come off our high horses. And we got to reach out to people we don't talk to. We got to do things we haven't done before. Because it's a real war out there. And not just the stuff I described to you earlier. It's a spiritual war. And we need to get more people on our side. And each of us has a responsibility to do so. You said you believe. So we got to humble ourselves. Yeah. Then it says, what does it say after you humble yourself, you got to do what? I know y'all read. I heard it. Pray. You got to talk it up. And you know what? So I heard a preacher say one of the hardest things to learn how to do is pray, man. Because for some strange reason, when it comes to praying, people think, I got to be in the silent place. I got to be in my private place so I can go down on my knees. You better learn how to pray standing. Because a lot of the information and the stuff you run into ain't when you on your knees. That ain't when you're being confronted. You ain't on your knees. So you got to learn how to pray standing. Do you know I pray going to work every day? I pray going to work every day. There's so many things that the car could break down. Somebody can come out of nowhere I have somebody out there shooting on the expressway. You know, the one time they be standing at the top and shoot at you as you go by on the bottom. That's real. I pray every day when I go to work. And I pray, especially when I come home, because there'll be more fools away then. I'm telling you what I know. They be up then. Y'all laughing, y'all acting like y'all don't know what I'm, but I, oh, thank God. He almost hit me, sideswiped the car. Oh, I was, thank God I was able to move out the way. So you got to learn how to pray everywhere. And you know what? You can pray for somebody and they don't even know you. See, somebody prayed for me, and it was a long time ago. And guess what? I didn't know they was praying for me. They prayed for me a long time, and I did not know. So I know you can pray for somebody else and them not know. And you know, it's the prayers of the righteous that avail as much. Because anybody can utter a few words. But it's the prayers of the righteous that avail as much. So now, if we will humble ourselves, pray. Didn't it say something about seek his face? You know what that means? Do you know what that means? I hope you don't take that literally and take the way it's written. It means look for God throughout everywhere you go. Look for him in this act. Look for him in this person. Look for him in your actions. Look for him in what you're doing. See, a lot of times we get hung up on ourselves and we think we got all the answers. Nobody in this room that's an adult likes to know it all. Nobody in this room likes to know. They like to think I'm equally yoked, so what I got to offer is just as good as what you got to offer. But you got to, the key is to look for God. Because God always does things for the greater good, especially for those who love. And his decisions benefit everybody. It ain't one side. Just like his justice. All have sinned. All have sinned. None of us are worthy to even touch his bowl. Oh, but he sent his son to atone for us. Son rose from the dead with all power. And I believe it. So seek his face. Look for Jesus. Something about that name I heard. Something about it. You've got to seek his face. And you know, I think about it a lot of times. I'm dazed and sleeping. Do a lot of you all, do visions pop up? I'm not crazy. Don't look at me like I'm mentally ill. Do visions sometimes go across your horizon? Well, it does me. I'm sorry. If I need to take a test, y'all need to tell me. But you know, visions come in and God show me things. And you know, and you could be wide awake or you could be asleep, but you see things and you wonder,
what the devil was that about? Where did that come from? How you showed up? What are you doing here? I'm just trying to say, God, he speaks to you. He put people in your life. You don't meet everybody everywhere you go. You don't know every human being walking by. But there's some small group you hang out with, a church family. He put all of us in here together. And for this time, we don't know yet what the outcome is going to be or why. But for this period of time, we are all here together on this journey together, seeking his face, learning how to humble ourselves, and constantly praying for better. That's why we're here. That's what we're doing right now. So then, we humbled ourselves. We pray. We are looking for him. And now, what's it say? What we got to do next? That's the hardest challenge yet. Because that's a challenge. And that's where that song the men sang came up and welled up and called the spirit to rise up in me. Because I didn't think anything I was doing was weak. I didn't see where it was hurting nobody. It was good to me. I didn't understand why I had to stop doing it. I'm just saying. I'm just saying. And I was having a good time. I thought I was all at a bag of chips and some more. Hit a brick wall. It wasn't a physical brick wall, but it was a spiritual one. And something told me, okay, you can keep doing that all you want, but you will never get into heaven doing it. You can enjoy all you want on this earth. Earthly pleasures. But it will not get you in heaven. And I've been turning ever since. Now I need you to know I haven't arrived yet. But I want you to know I turned at least 90 degrees. I might stretch it and say 180, but I think he's given me more time to preach his gospel, to serve him, and to let people know that it can happen for me, it can happen for you. He's going to turn it around, and by the time he's ready for me, I'll be ready for him. That's what it's about. And it took the first step. It took the first step. And I was like, Saul. I think about that. I think all of us have a Saul experience where we're going down one road. But then something happens and we turn around and our name changes to Paul. been known since I went to University of Florida. My name has always been Frederick Pennington, but when I went to the university, they shortened it. And I've been known as Fred ever since. Came here as Fred. So when I decided to make this change, or began to make that turn, I started writing my whole name. And I want you to know I presented my whole name to a few people that have, even people around here in this church that have been around me at least 30 years. And they wanted to know who that was. That's real. So now I have to tell people my name is Frederick. But I go by Fred. God changed Fred. Brought him to his namesake, Fred. And it's a work in progress. I'm not, definitely not standing here trying to tell anybody that I've reached that goal. But what I can stand here to tell you, if I'm striving and I'm in the gap and I'm getting what I need to keep climbing and keep fighting, that's what it's about. I'm on the battlefield. And I promised him so. I hear y'all don't like the conditions our world is in. And it's time for the church to be the church. I gave you a prescription about what we should do or what I should do, but I want you to know that I'm talking to each of you individually because your responsibility is the same in the circles you in the families you in, at the job. People need to know you are God. God's in you. I think I told y'all once before that I work in an office of non-believers and atheists. There is one Muslim, one Buddhist, the rest are atheists. So we are constantly having battles. They sent me all kind of texts last week about Easter. I text him back and say, he rose. I text him back and say, he rose. I get to work on Monday. How was church on Sunday? Oh, it was excellent. It started out at 6. I went to 10 o'clock. I said, we had a nice breakfast. I said, I had a great day. It's Resurrection Sunday. I say, and I came here to tell you that he arose for you too. He woke me up and sent me in here to tell you that he rose for you too. Even though you choose not to believe, he rose for you anyway. Ain't he a merciful God? Ain't he just great? I went off like that all day long. So they didn't bother me anymore. That happened this week. They come by my desk and they see the little, I get the notes from the students. You know, I write the little Christian notes and I put them up over the desk and they read them. And ask me what it means. I said, what does it mean to you? I said, they're talking about an awesome God. I said, but you got to know him before you can know what they're talking about. And all I can do is introduce you to him. You got to go get him for yourself. You got to go get, all I can do is introduce you to him. Because see, your soul, you got to work out your own soul salvation. I can't do it for you. Pastor Crutcher can't do it for you.
my people, those who are called by my name, would humble themselves, pray, seek, and turn. Then they'll, you know, them, that one of them clauses, conditionals. If then, not an if, my people. Then I will heal children playing the streets again. The old folks beating the carry their groceries across the street and they don't have to hug their pocketbooks. I don't have to worry about riding down that door and somebody standing up over me with an AK-47. Children, my grandchildren can go to school and they ain't got to worry about some fool standing there. Oh, I got mad at him last year and I'm going to shoot up the whole school this year. That's what it's about. So I offer the scripture and I ask you to plant this in your heart. Keep that scripture, that verse. Spread it abroad. Talk about it with other folks. Because that's all you can do. That's all we can do as individuals. And that's how we can help the church be the church. Thank you.
Let's give the Reverend Frederick Pennington a hand. The church is more than buildings and walls, but people who give their life to Christ. That's why we extend his invitation, not ours, to become a part of his family. And it's good to know that Christ gave the invitation to all of us. As we stand, there may be someone who wants to accept that invitation. We want you to know that you can become a part of the church today. There may be somebody that just needs a church home. You've already received the invitation and accepted it, but a place to grow so that you can learn how to act like a church. And those of us that are standing here, I want to ask all of us a question today. Can God have a worship in your church when you're not at 2525 West Church Street? Can he worship in your church on Tuesday evening, Friday night? Can he worship in your church when you are out of town? My God. Thank you.
I surrender all.
I was talking to you early. I wasn't making up a story. But when I was in the hospital, and Brother Rispus was in the hospital, and his eyes following his wife around that room. And you know, we didn't know it, but he was less than 24 hours of leaving here. And family and friends had gathered. And you saw him respond to the folk that loved him. And so, let me just say this. There's nothing in this world more important than family. We get caught up in the commercialized world, trying to make money, trying to be famous, trying to be sexy, trying to be sporty. But when it all comes down, when all of the other stuff pass away, there's nothing more important than family. And I want us to throw our arms around them. I need to share something else with you. When I headed to the hospital the next day, just before I got there, Sister Rispus had called Reverend Crutcher at the house and say, I just can't stand it longer. I got to go home. So I said, well, they're gone. And God said, keep going on. When I got to the hospital, his granddaughter, a couple of members were coming out of the hospital. And she was having a tough time, understanding that her grandfather was gone. Can I share something? You mind? And as we were talking with her, trying to get her to understand, she was saying, you know how you get when it hits you and you just not even in the world, in a whole nother world? And she was saying, we got to go get granddad. We can't leave him. And they was trying to get her to understand he's gone. He's dying. And when they said that to her, she literally stopped breathing. As if to say, if he's gone, I... Yeah. And so... And that's why church family, family members have to be there to love each other when we're going through. Because it just, when you're going through, does a world of good to know that somebody cares about you. Yeah. Kind word, a hand on your shoulder, a gesture, a prayer, we got you, or whatever it is. And I want us to be that kind of family, that when somebody's going through, there's somebody there to say, we got you. And what I love about it, you can even be going through yourself and still be there for somebody else. And somehow, if you do that while you're going through, it helps you to get through to help somebody else. Oh, God. So let us bow heads. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come now to just share love right now. In the name of Jesus, we come now, Lord, to share your love with a family that's going through this transition. God, we come now asking that you would bless a wife that will miss a husband. Bless, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Be strength where they're needed. Bless grandchildren that are miss grandfather. Bless, oh God, sons that are miss father. Bless cousins and nephews, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, let your anointing and your presence manifest, God. Let us our hearts bind together, God. And let love flow from one heart to another, God.
in the name of Jesus. Come on, God, to just be drawn into your presence. We ask that you would bless now, God, in the presence of your love. Strengthen, and God, just lift up countenance and hearts in the name of Jesus. And so right now, God, we bless your children. God, we release our love. We release our strength. We release an anointing, God, to just bless them in this time of need. So, God, in the name of Jesus, we receive the blessing. Thank you, Brother Fred, for a wonderful, Frederick, for a wonderful word. Amen, Reverend. Amen. And now we will praise God for whom all blessings flow.
All say.